Hello and welcome to Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning and I'm studying an ancient earthquake here in the Oregon Cascades. I'm sitting inside of a paleoseismic trench, which is a trench we've dug here across this fault line in the northern Oregon Cascades in order to study when its most recent earthquake was. During regional geologic mapping, a fault line was discovered running across this area in Lindsay Creek and next to Mount Defiance, which are two prominent landmarks in the Columbia River Gorge. This fault line was discovered through examining LIDAR topography, which uses lasers to map the ground without vegetation on top of it. When a fault line ruptures and creates an earthquake and it moves the ground on the surface, it creates what's called a scarp. A scarp is usually initially vertical, and it makes this big trace on the landscape that is easy to follow. We picked this site to dig this trench because here the scarp faces uphill, which shows that it could not have been created by erosional processes, and it is very certain right here that it is in fact a fault scarp. All through this old growth forest in the area, fallen trees are laying across it and really accentuate the steepness of this scarp. The fact that this scarp is so steep in this wet environment shows that it is likely a very young earthquake. Right now I'm sitting on the edge of this ancient fault scarp. This solid rock I'm sitting on is called a lodgment till. The geology of this area is most recently impacted by large glaciers that filled this valley and many of the other valleys around it. These glaciers likely date to the last glacial maximum, which was around 20,000 years ago. And as the glacier filled this canyon, all of the rocks and gravel and debris underneath this thick pile of ice was crushed down and created this lodgment till. Till is glacial debris that is poorly sorted and usually contains rocks of all different types and sizes. And since it's been squished and crushed below this heavy glacier, it is much more solid than the looser till around it. The walls of this trench are mostly made of what is called a meltout till. As the glacier melted and receded its way up the canyon, it left behind all this poorly sorted, washed out material on top. It generally has this reddish color, and so we see it throughout the area, and in other pits that we've dug in the area, we can measure it, and we see that it's consistent all throughout. During the last earthquake, this area was uplifted, and the area below me was dropped down. So we know that the soil thickness of this meltout till on top should be the same as the meltout till thickness at the bottom. However, there's about a 1.5 meter drop between me and the bottom of the trench. So during the last earthquake, we can measure that likely about 1.5 meters of vertical motion occurred during the earthquake. When this earthquake occurred, it also opened up a fissure in the ground, a big crack at the foot of the scarp. After the earthquake, debris from on top filled in the fissure below, and as that happened, pieces of charcoal from the soil of the forest floor filled it up. We can carbon date these charcoal samples as well as samples from elsewhere in the soil column and get an estimate for when this last earthquake occurred. All of the pink tags you can see along the walls of the trench are these charcoal samples, and we've collected quite a few, which gives us a lot of data with which to estimate the last time of this earthquake rupture. An earthquake scarp is usually really steep, and erosion likes to smooth things out. So over time, things fall off of the steep scarp and create what's called a colluvial wedge. Colluvium is gravity-driven debris. So as gravity pulls chunks off the side of the scarp, it creates a wedge of material out front of the scarp. Here, the colluvial wedge blends in with the fissure, making it very difficult to interpret the sequence of events. It's very difficult to determine where the fissure stops and the base of this colluvial wedge begins. And that affects the timing of the earthquake, because debris from this uplifted lodgment till, which would be called the free face if it gets exposed to air, will fall off on top of the fissure once the fissure fills in. This marks the base of the colluvial wedge generally, however here it's very fuzzy. One of the reasons we know that a fissure was formed here is because in the ground we can see this narrow band of squishy dark material that must have filled in after the earthquake. There are also pieces of this lodgment till and other local lava rocks that have fallen in and landed vertically. These vertical clasts paint a clearer picture of this fissure. Using the data we gather from analyzing the walls of the trench and the carbon dates we get from charcoal samples we've collected, we will be able to estimate the last time this earthquake ruptured and find out whether or not it presents a significant seismic hazard to the area, in addition to better understanding the tectonic history of the Cascades. Some of the regional geologic mapping has shown that lava flows in the area are offset as much as 250 meters over the last 2 million years, and younger glacial deposits as young as 20,000 years are offset between 2 meters here and 25 meters up the hill a little ways.
Oh, sorry. So they're 20,000 here, offset by 2, and the 25, those are probably like older, like the Jack Creek, so that's like 140K.
Here, these young 20,000-year-old glacial deposits are offset by about 2 meters, but further up, older glacial deposits as old as 140,000 years are offset by as much as 25 meters, showing that this fault has been active at least that long and likely much longer. The process here for scientifically logging this hole in the ground is pretty simple. After it's dug out by hand, because we're in a wilderness area, we have to clean and scrape the sides of this trench. After the sides are cleaned and scraped, we are able to better see the structures and stratigraphy of the sedimentary deposits and soils that are present here. In order to be consistent in our measurements of the different soils and stratigraphy, we have established a grid system. These white pins are on a 1 meter grid, except right here, where they're on a half meter step, because of the strange shape of this trench. This grid also helps us create a photo mosaic of this trench. Hundreds of photographs are taken of the north and south walls of the trench, and these are put into the computer and a 3D model is created, and this allows us to look at the trench even after we fill it in. This trench is being led by USGS geologist Scott Bennett, and I've been invited to help. I'm helping. I'm collaborating. I'm gonna be a co-author. Wow. This fault and this trench are being investigated as part of a USGS project led by Scott Bennett and Ray Wells from the USGS and Ashley Strigg from Portland State University, as well as myself and Ryan Levinson, her graduate students. This has been Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning. Thank you for watching.